In the last 25 years, the returns on various financial asset classes like bank deposit, gold, and real estate have multiplied several times. But there are a few select investments in the Indian capital markets that have had the potential to appreciate exponentially over 100 times. If you had known this at the right time, you would have taken the right investment decision. Which is precisely why you need an expert's validated advice when it comes to investing. Welcome to Barjeel, one of the few SEA-approved financial intermediaries in UAE. We are wealth builders, guiding customers since 2001. We have serviced over thousands of them till date, and today we cater to large segments across investor groups. This speaks about our enormous goodwill and their undiluted trust. And we have earned that trust by telling, not selling. We educate you on the investment opportunities that are ideal for you. We then help you make an informed decision, impartial and unbiased, keeping your long-term goals in mind. And with us, everything is long-term, be it commitment, relationships, or success. We offer comprehensive insights across a wide range of products through a holistic approach. We ask you the most important questions, the answers to which will help you focus on your investment objectives. For example, you work for over 30 years. Are you saving enough for the next 30 years? For life goals like children's education, your daughter's wedding, or your retirement. Think about it. You work hard to earn your money. Does your money work hard enough for you? Barjeel, let's build your future. Come, let's talk.
Gentlemen, and welcome to the 21st edition of the webinar series of Barjeel Geojit Financial Services. I'm sure you have been hearing a lot from us in the last few months. Because when the second wave and the market looked a little volatile, we started the webinar series again, and we have been doing it almost two such meetings every month, and this has been a time where investors have been feeling a little uncertain in terms of what is happening around the market. I'm being quite repetitive in that sense that we have gone through a phase during last year that nobody missed. And from a point where the markets were last year, I think the markets have more than doubled or close to doubled from where we were from the all-time lows. And today we are at an all-time high. So I'm not going to talk about what lies ahead or what is expected in the markets, which our keynote speaker is going to do today. But I'm going to share a common sort of an investor concern at this point of time that they are facing. That the typical question that we have been facing for most investors when we speak to them in terms of investing into the Indian markets today is it the right time? What should I be doing? Do I expect a correction to happen? The market has run up to 52,000 levels. The macroeconomic situation does not seem to look very conducive or for this market to be at this level. Will this market sustain? Will it hold? Where is the currency going? These are the sort of questions that we have been hearing over the last few months from investors. Most investors are ready to invest, and they are sitting in cash, and they are waiting for an opportunity to see what sort of a step they should take towards investing. Of course, in terms of markets, as we always mention, it is not that timing the market, but time in market. And we have got enough evidence to prove that equity investment probably is one of the best asset class that one can be in. And from a long-term perspective, it has delivered returns on a consistent manner, irrespective of what blips that we see in the during the tenor of one's life cycle of investment. In order to take us to this perspective, especially at the situation in the market at this level, and we are at the back end of the first quarter of 2021. So April, May, June, we saw the first quarter results of corporates were very good. We had a wonderful EPS report, the EPS earnings that we had seen in many companies and sectors. Now the question that is there in everybody's mind is, how is this quarter going to be and how are the next few quarters going to pan out for the Indian corporate and how is the market going to behave, not only from an India perspective, but also from a perspective of the events that are happening around the globe at this point of time. I'm extremely glad and very happy to have amongst us Mr. Shankaran Naren, a good friend of Virgil and a personal friend of mine, who he has been, I'm sure we have been hearing him consistently over the last many years talking to Virgil clients. Thank you very much, sir, for taking your time off and being with us today to talk to our clients and share your views. I always tell this that in terms of the fund managers in India today, Mr. Naren is probably very highly regarded in terms of his views and comments. He does not hold back his thoughts or his feelings in terms of what the markets are going to be. I remember a few years ago when we were in Dubai, he had made some very, for the first time I heard an equity fund manager saying, put your money in debt. And that was the time when, and he has been proved time and again correct in his point, in his viewpoints and his perceptions about the market. Before I invite Mr. Naren to speak, I will introduce him briefly for the benefit of the audience today. And also at this juncture, welcome our investors who are based in Muscat, Bahrain and Kuwait who are joining this webinar. We have had a very good response for this webinar from all our clients in the GCC. And as a matter of fact, a lot of questions have already come in for Mr. Naren after he finishes his talk. I would also encourage all of you to use the Q&A box to put in your questions. So after Mr. Naren finishes, I would pick up a few relevant questions and consolidate some of the common questions and put forth him for his views. Please note that please don't ask any stock specific question to Mr. Naren. He may not be able to reply to those, but anything related to an investment or a fund perspective, he will certainly be able to address. With this few words, I take this opportunity to introduce Mr. Shankaran Naren, who is the Executive Director and Chief Investment Officer at ICICI Prudential Asset Management Company, one of India's largest asset managers. He is widely recognized as India's leading mutual fund and capital market investment guru. He has a rich 3-decade experience in almost all spectrum of financial services industry across investment banking, fund management, equity research, and stock broking operations. Having been associated with the ICICI Prudential AMC since October 2004, he oversees the entire investment function across the mutual fund and international advisory business of the company. Under his leadership, the AMC has been able to build strong processes in investments, resulting in strong and sustainable performance across product categories. He currently manages some of the flagship schemes of ICICI Prudential Mutual Fund. Mr. Naren was also a member of the esteemed panel of invitees for the Honorable Prime Minister's pre-budget consultation meet in 2020. In recognition of his work, various leading investment authors have featured him through dedicated chapters in their investment books. During his career, he has worked with organizations such as REFCO, Citi Securities India, HDFC Securities Limited, and Yoha Securities in various roles. With this words of introduction, may I now open the floor open to Mr. Shankaran Naren. Welcome, sir.
Thank you for the kind words, Krishnan. It's a pleasure to talk to all Virgil customers. This time virtually. Wishing all of you all a good health first. I think that's the most important, as we have seen. I think the markets have been remarkable, if you ask me. I think last year in June, July, August, when India's cases were going up, I did not expect such a buoyant market rally. Then I realized that the US Federal Reserve and the central banks had put too much money in the market, that what happened in COVID was irrelevant. What mattered was the amount of liquidity that had been put into the global markets. And after that, we got the broad trend right. And we are having a phenomenal rally after that. See, basically, we have to accept that what has happened at this point of time in the market is that there are these global central banks led by the US, there is Japan, there is Europe, and other central banks. Together, they have put $25,000 billion of money to work in the period after 2008. that $25,000 billion of work that they have put has resulted in a massive global rally. And that has led to this market going to this level. What are the other impacts? As I was just discussing with Krishnan and Mr. Shamsuddin, basically we are in a situation where we are having the lowest interest rates that you're getting in FCNR, the lowest interest rates you're getting in NRE, the lowest interest rates you can get in deposit rates in any part of the world, the lowest interest rates you can get in debt anywhere in the world. So that has resulted in this massive market rally across the world, in all parts of the world. And I believe that this kind of a rally is going to continue for a long period of time, as long as the global central banks continue to put this kind of money to work. Look at what happened in the last week's Fed statement. Everyone said inflation is coming, dot plot, there's some talk of interest rate hike. But what Mr. Jerome Powell said is that I'm going to think about talking about tapering. He didn't even stop tapering. They continue to print $120 billion a month, so which means $4 billion a day. But they're not stopped tapering. Tapering is continuing. There is still $120 billion a month. And are they increased interest rate? The answer is no. So I believe that this bull market is all about the money being printed by the central banks and interest rates being at zero. And as long as you keep interest rates at zero and you keep printing money like this in this manner, you will have a buoyant stock market. And that is the way we think at this point of time. Is there a problem in India? Has India printed too much money? The answer is no. That is why even today, for example, in an NRE account, you at least get some interest rates, because in India, you have not done printing on that scale. But even in India, you get the lowest NRE rates today compared to what you are getting at any point of time, possibly in the last 20 years, maybe, or 30 years, or ever. So that is the reality of the markets at this point of time. And it will continue till the time the US Central Bank keeps printing. Is there a problem in the Indian business cycle? The answer is no. Credit growth is low. That does not signify a market top. Is current account deficit high? No. That means we are not at market top. Is there a capex cycle? Answer is no. That means we are not at market top. Is corporate profit to GDP low? Yes, it is. That means we are not at market top. So everything we can think about is suggesting we are not at market top. But then the US business cycle is at top. Corporate profit to GDP is very high. Everything, almost all loss-making stocks are at all-time high. Market cap to GDP is at all-time high in US and in India. Because of US, it is also high in India. So this is the kind of situation we are in. So essentially, what we are saying is that Indian equity market, US equity market, global equity market, every equity market will go up till the day Fed says, I am going to tighten, I am going to increase interest rates, I am going to pull out this $25,000 billion. When will they do that? I do not know. And frankly, I am someone sitting in Mumbai who is reading what is happening in US, but that is the reality. What should you all do? My view is that all of you should not have leverage from your own. You should be careful, because in the next 2 years, I'm more or less convinced that US will tighten. So you can't wait for US to tighten to say, I'm going to reduce my leverage. Even if leverage comes to you free, you have to be careful before it. At some point of time, US interest rates will go up. That I'm convinced about. So I believe that till the time US interest rates go up, markets will be good. But that is the factor that we all have to think about. And one should be having an asset allocation approach at this point of time. What does an asset allocation approach mean? An asset allocation approach means at this point of time, do not be leveraged. Have some exposure in cash, even if it doesn't make any sense. Have some small exposure in gold, even if it does not make any sense. Have some exposure in equity, even though it is overvalued. Have some exposure in commodity-oriented countries like Russia, even if they have not delivered any returns. Have some exposure in cheap stocks, which are good on dividend yield, good on operating cash flow, good on free cash flow, and all these kind of things, because they are much safer than buying, having stocks where there is no earnings, there is no dividend yield, there is only loss, and there is a promise of future 10 years from now, 15 years from now. This is what we believe in at this point of time. So what do we do at the, as far as mutual fund industry is concerned? In our view, there is very little opportunity in debt mutual funds, because we are a big believer that in the next 2 years, interest rates in the US will go up. If interest rates in US go up, interest rates in India cannot go down. So in the next 2 years, there is hardly any opportunity in debt mutual funds. Of course, old investments you can continue with maybe, but there is very little opportunity to make money in debt mutual funds. Your interest, your return currently in debt mutual funds will be capped by yield to maturity minus expense. Of course, like NRE deposits, here also you will get yield to maturity minus expense is what you will get. But it is not like last time I met Krishnan in 2017-18. Where at that point of time, it looked like interest rates will come down significantly. So at that point of time, when we met Krishnan, I actually told Krishnan, debt mutual funds are looking interesting because when interest rates are coming down, you make more returns. So today, if you look at all our debt mutual funds, you'll find that the three-year return is fabulous. Why is three-year return very good is because interest rates have come down. If I take the next 3 years, I believe interest rates will go up. So the returns that can be made in debt mutual funds is unlikely to be good at this point of time. Can you make what return you can make? You can make yield to maturity minus expense. So that is the kind of return you can make. So what can you do? You can consider NRE deposits. You can consider FCNR deposits. Maybe you can consider products like arbitrage fund. These are things that you can consider because that is the way we look at it at this point of time, because there is not much choice available in debt at this point of time. So what are our learnings from equity? So what we did was we looked at what happens when market is close to all-time high. So we looked at all-time high of 1999. We looked at all-time high of 2007. We looked at all-time high of 2017. So in 1999, who are the people who lost maximum money? People who invested in technology funds. In 2007, who lost maximum money? People who invested in infrastructure funds. In 2017, who lost maximum money? People who invested in small cap funds. So what we realized is when you are at all-time high, what should you do? You should not invest in the theme of the moment. You should invest in widely diversified funds. In 1999, if you had invested in a widely diversified fund, you wouldn't have lost money. Whereas people who invested in technology funds lost money. In 2007, people who invested in widely diversified funds did not lose money. Similarly, in 2017, people who invested in widely diversified funds did not lose money. You can see that from past data. I'm sure Krishnan will be able to support this data very, very clearly to you. So we are again at all-time high. So what do? You invest in widely diversified funds. So what are the widely diversified categories? One is clearly asset allocation categories. That is one. Second is very clearly you have multi-asset categories. that is again widely diversified categories. For example, multi-asset categories invest in equity, they invest in arbitrage, they invest sometimes in gold, they invest sometimes in exchange-traded commodity derivatives, they sometimes write covered call options, they invest in debt, they invest in so many things. So that is widely diversified categories. Then what is the third category is investing in flexi-cap. These are three widely diversified categories. And our learning is that when you invest in widely diversified categories, you actually tend to lose the least and you have the potential to make the most. You go back to 1999, if you had invested in a widely diversified category, 99 to 2004, you had good chance to make money. If you had invested in technology, you wouldn't have made money. If you had invested in 2007 to 2012, in infra, you wouldn't have made money, but in widely diversified category, you had a good chance to have made money from 2007 to 2012. 2017 to 2020, you made no money in small cap, but in other categories, you would have made money. So like that, today, you invest in widely diversified categories. What is the second benefit? The second benefit is in new fund offers. What is the advantage with a new fund offer very clearly is that the fund manager is not under pressure to deploy. Why is the fund manager not under pressure to deploy? Let's assume I'm running a fully invested strategy. Let's assume I'm running a fully invested large cap strategy. I get money in that strategy. I cannot go and take a cash call because I'm measured against all the other large cap strategies. Whereas suppose I'm launching a new fund offer and it's a widely diversified kind of strategy like FlexiCap and I get money in that strategy, what happens is I have all the flexibility to invest slowly. I have the flexibility to use all the flexibility that the SID gives me, the scheme information document that the regulator gives me permission on. Because at the end of the day, I'm not measured on day one against all the peers. So and what is the biggest worry we have in the next 2 years? It is US interest rates, US inflation. What will US central bank do? What will Fed do? When will Fed withdraw the monetary spigot? Those kind of things are the biggest worries that we have. So there again, if you look at it, a new fund offer with wide flexibility turns out to be one of the best ways to look at investing. So this is how we look at it at this point of time. When do we think is the best time to get invested? It is the best time to get invested is into the correction that a global interest rate increase creates. Can you correctly time it? Answer is no. Because the problem is, this is like March 2020. March 2020 was the best time to invest. How many investors listening to this webinar invested in March 2020 or February 2020 or April 2020? If there are investors who correctly invested in March 2020, then they can time it perfectly. If there are investors who invested in October 2008 after Lehman failed, who invested in November 2001 after World Trade Center bombing happened, who invested in October 2008 after Lehman failure happened, or in March 2020, for those people, they are all super smart investors. For them, you know, the timing can happen perfectly. They, first of all, don't need a mutual fund in my opinion. I think they are perfectly capable of investing directly through Burjeel Securities. Why do they need Burjeel Geodid? Why do they need ICICI mutual fund or any other mutual fund? This is my view. So I believe that clearly, but in my experience, and I've got 32 years of experience, we have 25 years in ICICI mutual fund almost today. And on that basis, I can tell you 90% of the investors did not invest after World Trade Center bombing, did not invest after Lehman failure, did not invest in March 2020. I won't even say 90, I'll say 99%. There was a 1% who invested, and that 1% should use Bajaj Jyotit Securities to do direct equity. This is my reading. For the others, clearly a flexible equity fund is a very, very interesting opportunity. A flexible NFO investing, capable of investing in flexible equity, is also a good opportunity. This is how I look at investing at this point of time. So essentially, what do we look at this point of time? We think that there is a good potential correction when US interest rates go up. People call me and say, when is it coming? Is it coming in next 3 months? I tell them, if I knew when it is coming, I will tell you. $25 trillion money is staked on that. Do you think I will ever know it correctly? Answer is no. If I know it, I'll act. If I know it, I'll act. But and the money has to be with me. Because, you know, it will come, how it comes, how the market falls. All these things are art. But at some point of time in the next 2 to 3 years, it is coming. That I'm more or less certain about. And it is important that even today, it makes sense for people to have no leverage. And why I always tell in any meeting in Dubai, because whenever I invest in, come to Dubai, I find that leverage is a very, very positive word. When I'm in India, I find that leverage is a negative word. So I never worry in India. I never use the word leverage in any sales meeting in India because I find people don't take leverage in India. But in Dubai, somehow, no, because Indians go to Dubai, they find that you get interest rate at 0 or 1. They feel like taking leverage. So my honest request to all the people in Gulf, don't take leverage now. It's already too late to take leverage. First, unwind your leverage. After that, what you do is something you can consult Burjit, George, Krishnan and others. But that is my view at this point of time. When the correction will happen is not known to ICICI Mutual Fund. If we knew, we would tell you. But we are very confident that you have to be more careful in the next 3 years than you were between 2014 and 17. At the same time, unlike 18 and 17 and 19, there are no big opportunities in debt. If there were, I would be happy to tell you. I don't think there are any easy opportunities in any market anywhere in the world, except a few commodity markets. That's what I can see at this point of time. So believe in cash flow, believe in dividend yield, believe in operating cash flow, believe in free cash flow, believe in being sensible. Don't get caught up by the greed of the market at this point of time. There is no fear in the market as I can see, but don't get caught by the greed of the market. And in the near term, if you don't seem to be making too much money, it's okay. That is how I think we all need to look at this point of time, because in the next 3 years, if you don't get consumed by the greed of the market, I think you'd come out all right. And that is how we think at this point of time. Luckily, you're with good people. So I don't think you need to worry. And I believe that there is no India-specific real worry I worry about. Because in India, people have been very cautious. COVID-1 hit, COVID-2 hit. You have had so many problems involving NBFCs. We have had so many bank NPL related issues. We had had so many issues. All the top corporates have deleveraged. Lot of banking related problems were there between 2011 and 20. So I don't see specifically an India oriented issue except high valuations. And the reason for high valuations is primarily US Fed and other central banks. Nothing to do with India. So this is all I have to say. So I think invest, but invest with care, avoid leverage, and await opportunities. If you see the opportunity, pounce. This is what I would look at. Thank you all.
Wow. That was a wonderful and concise talk, Mr. Naren. I think you drove home the point very well. I think, and the core message that you have conveyed is to be in a diversified sort of a mode right now. I've been getting a few questions, but before I log into the questions, I've been reading a few questions. Some of them are still not very clear when you say diversified funds. And they're still asking me questions like, which sectors I should be investing. So can you please explain in terms of what should be an ideal diversification strategy when it comes to investments in mutual funds in India?
See, yeah, in India, no, thanks to the regulator, we have thematic funds, we have diversified funds. So if you take a flexi cap category, it can invest in large, it can invest in mid, it can invest in small. You can choose to the ICICI Prudential Flexi Cap NFO, where I think which we are proposing to launch on Monday. It can invest in large, mid, or small, any of them up to 65%. And 35% can be in cash. We can use derivatives up to 45%. We can also write covered call option on our holdings up to 30% of our holdings or 15% of the entire equity portfolio. So what happens, it becomes one of the most diversified portfolios. So if you take the ICICI Prudential Multi-Asset Fund, it is a portfolio which can invest in equity. In equity, it can invest in large, mid, small. It can invest in commodities. It can invest in commodity derivatives. Commodities, primarily gold. It can invest in exchange-traded commodity derivatives. It can invest in REIT. It can invest in InvIT. It can invest in debt. So it has a wide thing. Whereas if you take, for example, we run a strategy like ICICI Prudential Infrastructure Fund. It can only invest in infrastructure-oriented stocks. We have a strategy like ICICI Prudential Commodity Fund. It has done exceptionally well. But if you invest in ICICI Prudential Commodity Fund, the return is more than 150% or something like that, very high return on 1 year basis. But it is not a diversified fund. So what happens is, if commodities fall, the fund can deliver bad returns. So it's not a diversified fund. Whereas if you look at commodity fund or technology fund, both the funds have done exceptionally well in our basket, but they're not diversified funds. So what happens is, what we believe is that if I look at the next 2 to 3 years, what are the sectors where we think gradual investing would help? We think maybe over a period of time you invest in banking, it would work. We like telecom as a sector. We like auto as a sector. We think gradual investing in auto would help. So these are some of the sectors we do well. So we think that, you know, when we take mutual fund industry, if you invest in a theme and the theme goes out of favor, actually investors may not have the best benefit. So that is why we tell people invest today in a diversified fund at the top, because if the theme goes out of favor, the chance of losing money exists. How did people lose money in 1999 to 2001? They invested in technology fund and technology went out of favor. In 2007, people invested in infrastructure fund and infrastructure went out of favor. That's what I mean.
Yes. Thank you, sir. I think there's one specific question regarding ICICI funds. It says a few days back, there was a report saying that you are sitting on high cash position. Is it correct? And what do you anticipate in terms of the investments in this sort of a mode?
See, we have what we call as ICICI Prudential Balanced Advantage Fund. We have a fund. In that fund, what we do is, based on valuation of the markets, as the market goes up, we keep selling. As the market goes down, we keep buying. So if you look at that fund, last year in March 2020, we bought almost 5,000 crores of stock in that fund last month. Last year, March 2020. Because the valuations is expensive right now, we have been selling stock in that fund. And that fund has much lower equity weightage than what it was before because of that reason. So they would have taken what was the equity level in May 2021 and compared it with what we would have had in March 2020. But in that strategy, which is 31,000 crores, clearly as the markets go up, we have to sell, because that is the nature of what we have committed. And as I mentioned, an asset allocation kind of strategy is the best strategy for any investor. Just imagine, in that fund, last year in March 2020, we continuously bought. And that was something which turned out to be one of the best decisions. We didn't have to go to the investor. We had cash in the fund. And we believe that in the next 2 to 3 years, markets will be volatile. Valuations are expensive.
we'll be in a position to buy equity in that fund when the markets correct. And that's the nature of the fund. So that is what people are using at, because that fund is 31,000 crores, it kind of distorts the overall equity levels of the fund. So if you give us money for, in an equity fund, we may not have much cash, but in that fund, we would have cash.
Thank you, sir. I think for the benefit of the audience today, Mr. Naren mentioned about the proposed NFO of ICICI FlexiCap Fund. From a regulatory perspective, I must say that we have applied for an approval for this NFO with the regulator, local regulator here, SCA, and we hope to get it in the next few days. The moment we have these approvals, we will be able to share all the details to the investors at large over here. Sir, there's also a question about investing in the Global Advantage Fund. So from an Indian perspective, what is your views on investing in funds outside of India, the US markets and global markets?
See, when I'm talking to Barjeel George, customers have to think slightly differently, but locally people are very confused in India. Should I invest in US? Should I invest in China? Should I invest in Japan? Should I invest in Asia? So they used to call me and say, what should I do? So we said, let's create one fund where we can invest in everything. So this is a fund which is invested partially in US, partially in Japan, partially in Asia, partially in China. So, and we can toggle, we can increase the Asia component, we can reduce the US component, we can do what we want within the fund. But for Dubai customers or GCC customers, you have the ability to invest directly in these markets on your own. So is it valid for you? I do not know very clearly. But for Indian customers, we have been telling people to Indian customers that you should look at it. Because end of the day, it's so complex. No one is able to understand whether they should invest in Asia or should they invest in US. So we tell them, you give money here. No, we will take the decision of cutting US and increasing Asia, cutting Asia and increasing Japan. All those things we will take. But you, for your customer, they can take that decision on their own. So should they choose this product? I'm not clear, Krishnan.
You're absolutely right. I mean, they have options to do direct dollar investments into the global markets from the perspective of being an NRA. Another question that is always has been there in the last few months rather is the way the inflation has been growing in India. Now we have had some of the from food inflation to commodity inflation and to the crude oil inflation. What in your view is this is going to lead to? Do you think it will stabilize or this is going to be a sort of a concern area from the RBI perspective, and what probable impact it could have in the markets?
I think in the near term, I think RBI is not likely to do anything, but I believe in the medium term, as and when Fed also increases rates, India can also increase rates. That's one of the reasons why, you know, unlike when we met last, physically, we are not recommending in a big way a area like debt mutual funds. And I believe that 18 to 24 months from today would be a better time to consider big investing in debt mutual funds. And in today's recommendation, I preferred a category like arbitrage or equity savings kind of category over debt at this point of time. For the same reason, because I believe that interest rates will go up over the next 2 years. And I don't think inflation is a local worry alone. I think inflation is a global worry. It is a problem across the world.
Sir, one of the, I think in the budget speeches over the last 2-3 years, and even in this last budget speech, a lot of talk was on the divestments that the government is proposing to do. Do you think that this year you will have more divestments coming, which will give the funds or investors to participate in those divestments, and also the online? How do you see the pipeline of IPOs that are likely to hit in the near future in 2021?
There will be a number of IPOs, but whether they need to be from government or they will be from private sector, I think a number of them will be private sector, internet, and all those kind of things. I think in many of them, we have to do our own channel checks and check whether they are overvalued, undervalued, etc. I think there is a lot of care that investors have to take when they are investing in IPOs. This is my learning after being a IPO investment banker between 1990 and 94. It was my first job. I learned my first equity research as an IPO investment banker between 1990 and 94. That is long back, 27 years back. I can tell you, I would request all the investors when they are investing in IPO to do proper research if they are going to invest in a big way. But I think divestment should happen on the strategic side. With the exception of LIC, I would say bulk of the divestment should happen on the strategic side and not through IPOs. I'm only hoping that they manage to do IPO of LIC this year, and the rest of the divestment should happen on the strategic side. I'm hoping that BPCL, Concor, Air India, all these divestments happen. And if movement happens also on the two public sector banks, I'll be very thrilled. I think the government has taken a superb decision to do strategic divestment. If they do it, I will be very, very happy.
So in your talk, you mentioned about getting into diversified funds. So do you mean to say that that small cap and mid cap are highly valued at this point of time, and we should not be looking at it?
I am clearly of the view that small and mid caps are not cheap at this point of time. Most of your direct equity customers would recognize that their portfolios have seen good rallies. And it is not like 1 year back. I have a framework that if any category gives you 100% kind of return, you have to be more careful. This is one of the checklists I have based on Dr. Atul Gawande. Any fund gives more than 100% 1 year return, I'm more careful. Any fund gives you minus 40% 1 year return, I'm very, very positive. These are two principles which are there based on Dr. Atul Gawande's checklist. So on that basis, you know, as I mentioned earlier, commodities has given more than 100%. Some of the sector, small cap has given more than 100%. So those are things where I'm a bit more careful because they have given more than 100% at this point.
So from purely an audience question perspective, there's a lot of questions that have come on sector-specific funds. So my question, I want to rephrase the question to say, which sectors do you think are on a good performing mode right now, and which are the sectors that you would not be looking at this point of time?
See, we are positive on telecom, we are positive on power utility, we are positive on auto, we are reasonably okay on pharma. We were okay on IT till recently, but every day shares keep going up. I think we'll get more and more constructive on banks with time. These are some of the things. One of the ways in which we have created a strategy like Global Advantage, we have created a strategy called Thematic Fund of Fund. It'd be interesting for investors to look at that strategy, both from the point of view of what it owns and whether they want to consider it for investment. That tells you where are we invested in. So from that fund, we invest only in themes, theme stocks, theme funds. So you'll get an idea of which are the themes which you are betting on at that point of time. Because our view has always been, we are worried that people come into the theme fund at the wrong time.
Correct. Another question that typically comes from the NRI segment as large is the rupee-dollar parity. I think of late, if you see, the dollar has been appreciating over the last few weeks, and rupee has suddenly started to depreciate in the last few weeks. So where do you think this will lead in the near future? How do you look at the rupee dollar parity this year?
No, I've been of this, you know, in this 2011-13 dollar rupee move, I got it correct for a change. But this time I'm not bearish rupee against dollar. But I am bearish dollar against all the current account surplus countries. Which are the current account surplus countries? They are Singapore, Taiwan, Korea, Japan, Switzerland, Netherlands. Netherlands doesn't have an independent country. Russia. These are the countries against which I think that US dollar can depreciate. But rupee dollar, I am not a believer that 74 goes to 100 or something. I'm not a believer. And I believe that dollar itself is likely to be weak, has been my view. But last 2 weeks has surprised me.
So last year we saw a huge FII flows that came into the markets. And now there has been a sort of a lull or a quiet period. So when you're talking to international investors, what is their perception at markets at these levels? And do you think that we will see a reversal of flows or not like last year, but more positive flows are likely during the later part of this year?
Somehow it's very difficult to predict, but I'm a believer that when that global correction happens, there will be selling. And whether the global correction happens in 1 year or 2 year or 3 year, that I also don't know, as I mentioned. But I believe that when US rate hike happens, I think equity will get derated all over the world. This is my personal view. They get derated all over the world.
Your thoughts on cryptocurrency?
I don't have a thought. Luckily, our regulator says, don't talk about it also. So I'm very happy.
I think in all our sessions, you know, we are flooded with questions, and especially being away from India, you know, there is a keen desire to do something with the crypto. Thankfully, like you, we also don't really promote our because there is no regulated platform. You know, we are happy to offer, but there is no regulated platform to trade the currency at this point of time. So, I mean, this is a question that keeps coming in every session that we have been doing in the last 3-4 months. There is always a flow of questions on, do you think cryptocurrency is worth looking at? So there's a lot of, there are fintech startups that are available in India, and many startups that are also doing quite well. But then there is also a news flow that many of them are going to come with IPOs and capture the market. And when we see those valuations and the performance of these companies, what is your view in terms of those companies coming to hit the market with huge losses in their books and then with the expectation that they will do well in the future? Should somebody seriously look at investing in startup IPOs or as a mutual fund? What would be your thoughts when you're looking at such investment opportunities?
What I mentioned just some time back, that when people are looking at IPOs, I said I spent 1990 to 94 being an IPO banker. I think the same question holds good. I think it's the toughest part of my life to evaluate these IPOs. I am struggling. The struggle has just started. I think next year is going to be a big struggle for me.
True, I understand. I think I was also an investment banker like you at that point of time. And thankfully, we were governed by the CCI guidelines of valuation, which we also felt was a little high when we were doing the valuation. But things have changed dramatically over the last many years.
But you know how many companies in those times became junk and they don't exist? If you look at the number of issues you and I were involved in and how many of them do not exist today, you'll be pretty surprised.
Absolutely. I think we have a history behind us for that. Sir, you mentioned in your initial thoughts about putting money in commodities, do put a little money on gold. Is it possible for you to give a rough a percentage estimate to say a normal investor, what sort of, what should he be looking at?
I can't take your role or the role of an asset allocator or a CFP or anything like that. I can't take away your role, Krishnan. That is your role. I can only say that it is complex at this point of time for you to ignore anything.
True.
And luckily, our regulator says, don't talk on crypto. I'm happy I don't have to talk on crypto.
Great. We ask this question every time just to see whether we are in the right direction. And like I mentioned to you, you always share your thoughts very freely. I think you have made the point very clear at this point also. So I think we'll rest the case at that point in time. A few concluding questions. Now that I think we have almost the first quarter is over, and then we are looking. How do you think corporate India is going to go forward? Are you still confident that we will be able to go back to what we did in the Q4 of last year? And from a general overall perspective, you seem to indicate that. We are not going to have a crash sort of a situation. Corrections and changes are always expected as part of our daily life. So what is your confidence level, or how optimistic of you are rest of the year, Mr. Naren?
So there's one point that I keep telling people now. And see, 2010 to 20 was deflation. Deflation is one person's output price going down. When output price goes down, earnings go down. Now you have inflation. In inflation, 1% output price goes up. When output price goes up, earnings goes up. When earnings goes up, it is very positive for earnings. So if steel price goes up, steel stocks, steel earnings goes up. If sugar price goes up, sugar price goes up. If oil price goes up, oil earnings goes up. So this is very good for earnings. So I don't think you need to worry about earnings. So in this period, what happens? Debt is not a good, duration is not a good asset class. But you don't need to worry about earnings. Earnings will keep coming. What happens to stock prices will be determined by Fed. But I don't think you need to worry about earnings. You need to worry about what will happen to corporate sector, whether corporate sector will do show good results. All those things you don't need to worry about. You need to think about what does Mr. Jerome Powell do. But you don't need to worry about whether this company will show good results, that company will show good results. All companies will show good results. We are like 2002 to 8 cycle. In that cycle, did you ever worry about any company showing good results? No, all companies are showing good results. Now also all companies will show good results. That is how I look at it. And people don't recognize that deflation is a very, very painful thing. In deflation, what happens? Even expenses get postponed. Now, if you know, let's assume steel price will go up from July 1. That person on June 30th says, give me the steel price. No, give me the steel today. So even the demand gets advanced. When demand gets advanced, business improves. See, inflation means demands get advanced. Deflation means demand get postponed. So that's why earnings and all, don't worry. Earnings will be good.
A few questions on coming up in terms of ETFs versus diversification. Are investments in India part of diversification? How do you look at it?
See, my personal belief has been that ETFs are like a competitor to us. We can't wish away them. But I think the biggest competition will come if people invest in products like our BSE 500 ETF. If you invest in a 50 ETF and say that is competition, eventually the small cap and mid cap will do well. When small cap and mid cap do well, we'll be able to do better. 2018, 19, 20 till September was a period only large caps did well. So we did badly. But I believe that if you want to really get the benefit out of ETF, you have to choose something like BSE 500. That kind of a product has a good scope. And we have created products like passive strategy, which involves investing in all the ETFs that we have.
Okay.
So that can be. But I think hopefully... But ETFs are going to be continuous competitors for us. It will keep us on our toes every day. Every day I have to wake up and realize there is a competitor called ETF.
I think, Mr. Rain, it has been wonderful hearing you today and hearing you and listening to your responses to the questions that we have had. I think the broad takeaway that we have is that from an Indian market perspective, there's no need for so much concern that people seem to have today. There's a need to diversify and plan your investments and be in cash at most points to take advantage of the opportunities that will come in the next few weeks and months for investors to invest in the Indian markets. And on behalf of Barjeel, Jyojit, and we had close to more than 400 people who had logged in on the webinar today. Plus, we also have the Facebook Live that is going on. The session is also being really on Facebook. So on behalf of all the attendees and on behalf of Barjeel, I wish to thank you once more for the time you have taken. And I would now request our director, Mr. Kudin, to formally propose a vote of thanks.
Mr. Shankar Narayan and our respected guest attending this webinar, very good afternoon. I am speaking to you from India. Last 3.5 months, I am in India, stuck because of the flight cancellation. One of the important information I want to share Sir Shankaran Narayan, as well as our friends attending this webinar. I had an opportunity to speak more than 1,000 people who returned from GCC countries because of the COVID-19 pandemic. One of the very interesting factors I could realize is many of them are investors in the mutual fund. They are really appreciating us, the benefit they received from the investment in the mutual funds. Many of the returnees living very happily with the income as SWP, systematic withdrawal plan, they are enjoying. So this is the one of the most important information I would like to share with our investors, as well as many of them specifically told we have a good investment in ICICI Prudential Mutual Fund. So it will be very good news for you also, Mr. Narayan. So this aspect, I want to request all our attendees today. We are regularly organizing at least every fortnight, we will be having one webinar. Please request your friends and relatives to attend, understand what we are, the experts are giving, advice we are getting from various fund houses and all, and give an opportunity to people, those who are not active in the stock market, mutual fund, and get an idea what is happening in India, this sector, how people are benefiting from investing in the mutual fund and stocks. So we are just advising other people also to participate in this kind of program. It will be a great service for the community. So I humbly request all the attendees, please share the forthcoming webinars to your friends and relatives. Get them opportunity to get the benefit of our country's economy. So that is a very important message I would like to share this time. I express on behalf of Virgil Jewish Financial Service and myself our sincere thanks to Mr. Shankaran Narayan. You always give a boost to the investors. Whenever you come us and give an event means, you will always give a boost to our investors. So I am very, very thankful to you. And again, I request all my dear attendees, without forgetting what I promised, and I express my sincere thanks to all of you for attending this program and make a success. There was more than, at a time, we have seen about more than 400 attendees. So I express our thanks once again. Thank you. Namaskar.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Samir and Mr. Alok, for organizing this. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. We'll be in touch. Thank you, sir.